Welcome to the On a Mission Mojo podcast, where I have the pleasure of interviewing impact-driven founders, entrepreneurs, authors, and business experts who are actively working to create a positive difference in our world. I'm your host, Lori Young, a branding specialist, certified master marketer, and a passionate advocate for brands that possess heart, soul, and an unwavering commitment to drive change for humanity. It takes grit, a visionary mindset, and an abundance of mojo to navigate this journey. And the stories I share will undoubtedly ignite your passion. If you're seeking an infusion of inspiration, motivation, and valuable insights to amplify your impact, let's dive right in. Welcome to episode 34 of the On a Mission Mojo podcast. We are going to be talking today about all things public relations, but from a very different viewpoint. Public relations from a very human-centric and very conscious standpoint. And I think it's a little bit different angle than maybe some traditional PR agencies might take. And I have with us today Ashley Graham, who is the founder of the Conscious Publicist, a PR advisory firm specializing in human-centric PR for high-growth thought leaders. With a deep belief in the power of storytelling, Ashley and her team are dedicated to helping clients build meaningful connections and relationships. She considers her work, people's relations, aspect vital in fostering a more conscious and sustainable world. By guiding clients in developing the necessary practices and strategies to align their connections with their goals, Ashley aims to shape a future where conscious living is the norm. And this is exactly why Ashley was just a great fit for the podcast, because for listeners who listen to the show regularly, you know that I have a lot of very conscious people, very human-centric people on the show, people that are really in business to make a difference in the world and to impact humanity in a positive way. So I just want to say thank you, Ashley, for what you're doing in the world and for bringing your expertise in a very human-centric and socially conscious way. So why don't we just start by you sharing a little bit with us about your mission and just your story, like why, like you're doing what you're doing, how you got.
Absolutely. Well, first off, Lori, thank you so much for just giving me the platform to use my voice. Mm-hmm. I believe that it's creators such as yourself that create this connection for visionary thinkers and leaders like myself to continue to feel the motivation and aspirations to push our mission forward, mm-hmm. which that actually leads into a beautiful introduction as to just who I am, what lights me up, and why I'm so passionate about my work. Mm-hmm. To get us started, I guess I would just say that I have always loved storytelling and narrative.
Okay.
My personality, I really connected not only with other people's stories, but I was such an avid reader growing up, and I loved just immersing myself into the stories that other creators and authors felt called to tell. Mm-hmm. That belief and that passion has continued to evolve and grow with me, like as a person and as a creator and a writer myself, which really builds this connection to what makes me perfect for being in the PR and media relations space, at least from my perspective. Mm-hmm. I believe that public relations and what I like to say, the people relations, still PR, mm-hmm.
right?
What I believe one of the most beautiful common threads between the two is it's building that connection and that energy between the creator, the voice, the writer, and how they're looking to connect with the reader or the viewer or the community or the audience that is connecting with their work. I believe that there's so much abundance when it comes to PR, at least from a conscious perspective, to really kind of make your mark in what you want to be known for and how you're looking to serve and impact the lives of others of who you're looking to serve with your message.
Okay, very cool. You know, as you were talking, one of the things that came up for me that just kind of reminded me of PR that's kind of going on today in the way that you're describing it is the Olympics. I just absolutely love it. I don't know if you're a fan of the Olympics, but I'm a huge fan of the Olympics and I watch it every single night. but I think what I love, like, more than anything about the Olympics is these little stories that they are highlighting athletes, and they're highlighting kind of like the behind the scenes, real human element of their story. You know, we see them out there competing and, you know, running for their life, or, you know, flipping and doing, you know, flips in the air or whatever, but we don't always see the real person and the human behind that figure, right? Or that athlete in this.
Yeah. You know, I don't follow the Olympics very closely, but I will say one of the things that I just love as just a viewer on social media is how creative partners of the Olympics or the Olympics themselves have taken some of the athletes and created their hero journey through content that's being published, whether in advertising or on social media. There's such a strong narrative of what's shared of the athletes and their journey of resilience, of what it took for them to get from the very early stages of their journey into where they are now. Mm-hmm. That to me, again, even not following so closely along, it's like that to me goes back into that just excitement and possibility of like how you can be so immersed in their journey and really learn what it took for them to get to where they are.
Yes, absolutely. Let's talk about like how your approach to PR is maybe different than other approaches. Like, let's talk about, I guess, what it means to be a conscious publicist in this world today.
Yeah. Well, I guess like I can always just lean to what I believe makes me different. And mm-hmm. outside of just strategy and approach and just the relationship that I bring to my clients, first and foremost, what I think the most valuable space that I nurture for my clients is really focused on the identity of what we're looking to create. Now, if I'm thinking about working with a thought leader who is very solo entrepreneur based, or anything that's being published in PR or the media is more so focused on them and their subject matter expertise, I believe that the transformation and the impact of the results that we get stem from how clear we are as far as the identity, the message, the narrative, and what we're looking to tell in the media. Mm-hmm. So I believe that, again, outside of just strategy and approach and just really diving into that, it really starts from a fundamental perspective of really diving deep into the identity and how they want to be positioned moving forward. From there, everything else becomes very synchronistic and harmonious because there's a lot of clarity of how that subject matter expert or that thought leader or client is wanting to make the mark in the media. And then it comes down to just being intentional about where we're finding opportunities for them. Mm-hmm. You know, the conscious approach for me, it stems into many facets, but conscious perspective as far as like working with the right media outlets is very much a part of the puzzle as well with our work. Mm-hmm. It's not always about getting them on every single media platform because externally it looks flashy and wonderful, but it's actually understanding the infrastructure of the editors that we're pitching, the tonality that they use in their pieces, and if the client actually is a really good fit to bring their narrative to that editor or journalist audience to mm-hmm. build a really strong connection. That's why, you know, in my introduction alone is really building the connection to just the relationship part, that it's not always just about the results that we get the clients, but it's building relationships with the media that we're building connection, that we're connecting our clients with, mm-hmm. not only to build a really strong narrative, but to almost open doors for other future opportunities because we value the relationship and the connection that we're bringing to the introductions.
Right. So let's, I guess, you know, I think one of the things to, for me at least, is this whole like positioning piece, like how we how we decide what's best in terms of how we position ourselves. And I'll just give you just a little small example of one of the ways that I'm positioning myself, like on social media and on my website. I don't do any like PR right now, but one of the concepts that came to me was to position myself as a business owner, strategic biz bestie. And I felt like for me, I looked at like, what do I bring? What makes me any different than any other, you know, online business manager, you know, master marketer that's out there in the world trying to work with business owners? And I felt like one of the things that makes me really, really strong is just my focus on relationships. What I bring is I kind of approach like business from a very like just different. I'm very relationship focused. Like people are first for me, but yet I'm very business minded and professional. So it's kind of like you get the best of both worlds. You don't get like this hardcore business person that, you know, has all the strategies, you know, to help you grow, but you also get like a very human-centric, very heart-centered business professional that kind of takes the approach of let me hold your hand as we grow your business. And so I'm trying on at least the concept of or the positioning of strategic biz bestie. And you know, let's talk just a little bit about that, like the positioning of a person and how pull like elements of who they are, their story, and what makes them different, and position them in a way that's like unique and attractive.
Yeah. So you want to dive into just some like really clear examples for that?
Yeah. Yeah. I think that would be great. That would be great. Yeah. I think examples give people, it helps like get the wheels turning in their brains about like how they might position themselves.
Absolutely. I'm going to do this almost kind of like two part. I have an ideation process that I go through with clients, and what you might know from looking at articles online or hearing other thought leadership experts is it's really focused around professional career and how you have really set the tone throughout your career to position yourself on what makes you the expert, like in your industry. So I do, and two, like I said, two part with the ideation process. I have another of a number of ideation questions that I usually ask clients to get the wheels turning, to get the thought process going, just to understand at least from their perspective how they've positioned themselves from a career standpoint and what drew them to thought leadership in the first place. But before I even dive into anything career related or anything professional related, I have a number of ideation prompts that talks more about them as a human being. I ask about if there was any memorable experiences that they have gone through in their personal life that they believe has completely transformed who they are as a person. Because, and I'm just going to lead with that example, I'm not going to try to dive into any others, but the reason why I think just a question or holding space around a question like that is so powerful is because it usually bridges a connection on how they have taken a personal experience and molded that and to become a better leader in their professional life or in their career. Because the thing is we often think that we are two separate people in our career and in our personal lives, but we are still the same person. We have the same personality. We still have the same skill sets. And especially if you're a relationship heart-driven person, the more that you are open and expanded in your personal life, the more empowerment that you're going to bring to your professional life. And those that you're in partnership with or those that you work with are just going to feel even more expanded in your presence, even if it's a professional setting. So like I said, I like to look at it as like dual identities, but they also often fuel one another in a very like powerful and impactful way. And then it just really sets up so much room for opportunity or fun to really explore what the different narratives could be for the clients. Obviously, having about 50% of the positioning be really focused on their career, their subject matter expertise, and obviously creating a story that brings awareness to their business, because that's part of it. But it's like, what other narratives and stories can we create that highlights you as a person that has transformed who you are as a way to be a better manager or a better leader or a better person of the spotlight on how you can guide others personally or professionally? So I like to bridge the connection between the two.
Yeah. And you know, and that brings up another question for me, and that is, how much of our personal life do we need to share in order to make that connection with people and, I don't know, kind of have them buy into like your story? Like, I hesitate with that. Like, as open as I am, like, I'm a very vulnerable, very open person. And, you know, I share a lot of stories probably on my podcast. And even in social media, but I still hesitate with how much of our story do we share? How vulnerable do we get with our story, and like why we or how we became who we became?
I think the biggest part to that is you can share whatever you are comfortable sharing or have the courage to share. I think as long as it comes back to a central why, it's like, why am I sharing this? What is the reason? What am I hoping to achieve by sharing, you know, more personal stories? As long as it connects to a greater why, if that fuels your business or it fuels your like career personality as well, then it goes back to a why, and those can work and co-create simultaneously and harmoniously with one another. But I also think that there's different platforms for you to be a little bit more personal or more narrative-based, or to be more professional and more career-based when it comes to thought leadership. I like to say that the thought leadership like space is so abundant and there really is no right or wrong way to take advantage of the gifts that are being offered. Again, I think just the most important thing is to come back to why. Like, why are you spending the time and the energy or the resources to share a personal story, and what are you hoping to achieve with it? And if it's a way to bring awareness to your business, then fantastic. I feel that with personal branding, the audience or people are already used to wanting to know more about the person anyways. And so this is why I think that there needs to be a balance between both personal narrative and business narrative, because people buy into other people. They buy into the relationships. You are able to create that know, like, and trust factor through a personal narrative, which just creates more excitement and enticement for people to want to work with you in a business capacity anyways. So I think as long as, again, going back to that key word balance and making sure that there's a purpose as to why you're sharing the personal narrative, but then not letting that become the precedence, having a good balance between the two is key.
Yeah. So taking that personal narrative and tying it into the professional or the business narrative, and like bridging the gap between the two.
Absolutely. Okay. Yeah. Cause I mean, I could always like, there's so many examples too, of even from, you know, my more executive level, like thought pieces that I've worked on with clients is if we're working with a publication that is prompting questions to the client in an interview, whether it's in person, on Zoom, or a written like digital interview, the first question that's usually asked is like, what led you into your business or led you into your career? And every single one of my clients have always led into a personal story of whether there was family influence or they really found a problem in their industry, or they, you know, didn't experience the type of like environment that they wanted in their career, and they wanted to create it for themselves. So it's like even executive level media are wanting to lead in with the actual personal story because it really sets the foundation for the rest of the interview and the rest of the conversation.
Right. Yeah. So let's talk, I guess, I want to talk about the whole concept of thought leadership because it's a big buzzword. Tons of people are talking about becoming a thought leader. You need to be a thought leader. What exactly does that mean to be a thought leader?
To be a thought leader, again, I can always just say from my perspective, is making a mark on how you want to be known or recognized from your audience or from others.
Okay.
I always lead with the sense that, like, again, I believe that thought leadership is very abundant and very universal, that it's not even in the traditional sense of needing to be recognized in a career or in a professional context. When you think about some, you know, large public speakers who have really leveraged social media or leveraged media to be known for a one thing or what their main focus is of their story and narrative, they've just really mastered the mix of consistency and building credibility and authority around that topic or that subject matter expertise. Mm-hmm. Again, I believe that from the traditional sense, thought leadership was more in a professional setting of needing to be the best. And I'm just going to like free flow here. I'm not thinking about like the best identities, but thinking about like, oh, the, you know, the most notable HR leader or the most notable executive coach. It's like you now have thought leaders who are being known for, you know, leading with heart or what are some of the other things? Like being known for, you know, spirituality or leading with, you know, purpose through nonprofits. Like you have thought leaders who have just really understood that why factor and have just been really consistent with every single opportunity that has presented to them to lead with the story and narrative of their why. I think even Simon Sinek is known for, like, you know, getting back to that purpose of why. I believe that even he is a thought leader in his own space, both personally and professionally, because he's really nurtured the media space to create that identity for himself.
You know, like when you describe thought leadership, it's different than a lot of the gurus that I have seen online speaking about thought leadership. Like I have seen thought leadership described as someone who is an innovator, someone who brings different ideas about a particular subject that other people aren't bringing. So it's almost like if you are not bringing like these grand innovative ideas and shifting perspectives about a particular topic, then you're not a thought leader. You're just an expert. Like, do you agree or disagree with that?
I don't know if I would agree or disagree.
Okay.
Yeah. That's fair. And the only reason why I say that is because like even like thinking about that language of being a luminary thinker or an innovative thinker, it's like I still think that you can be a thought leader given that ability to innovate ideas. But you can also be a little bit more relaxed in the sense that you can have innovative ideas, but then you can also just be a human being and a creator and feel lit up about other passions that also can be a part of your thought leadership identity or your thought leadership journey. I think ultimately, again, it goes back to that dual part of that ideation process that I go through with my clients is like, there's still like personal experiences that I think could add into their thought leadership positioning, but then also their innovation, their luminary thoughts around their career or personal life or where they really see change needing to be done, you know, in the world as a collective as well.
Right. Yeah. I think thought leadership is very
universal.
Right. I think that's probably where, at least me personally, I get hung up is that I see that definition of thought leadership, like, described so much online that I tell myself, like, are there really any new ideas? Like, can I really come up with any kind of new idea that someone has not already heard? And I don't know that I believe that I can, honestly, because first of all, I read a lot of stuff like on LinkedIn, and like I feel like the same information is just regurgitated in a different kind of way, from a different viewpoint or a different perspective, but it's the same information. It's like there's nothing, it's very rare that I come across something that goes, wow, that was like mind-blowing. That's something like I've never heard before. So how do we like work with ourselves like mentally to get past? I mean, I'm a high achiever. So it's just like I take this approach of like, wow, like I can't be a thought leader. Sure, I can provide my expertise, but a thought leader is a whole different level.
I would say, and this is my perspective, power mm-hmm. of perception, right? Is like, mm-hmm. I would still envision you to be a thought leader in your own way. Kind of like what we were ideating before we hit record was like, even just thinking about the identity of your show, like mm-hmm. On a Mission Mojo, there was something that triggered that identity for this show for you, and how that connects either to the guest that you have on the show or the audience that you're hoping to serve through the story and the message that's being told. Mm-hmm. Through that consistency and always building the threads, like you said, you're very intentional about the guests that you bring on. You're very intentional yes. as to why you do the show. That makes you a thought leader in this way, because you are creating a story and a narrative that has a bigger purpose of hopefully guiding and bringing perspective and perception and guidance to those that you're looking to serve through the narrative. Again, that's I true. Believe thought leadership is it's universal. And I would almost say that any creator, especially podcasters, are thought leaders in their own way, because they've gone through the very similar mindset of what even high growth thought leaders have gone through, of being able to see a disconnect and knowing how they are the ones to really guide the conversation.
It's funny that you say this, because I want to talk through, just because I think this can be helpful for listeners that are maybe struggling with whether or not they feel like they can be, you know, a thought leader. You know, when we talk about like my show On a Mission Mojo, the whole idea behind the show and my whole reason for having this show is to elevate the difference makers in our world, to find people who are actively in the trenches trying to make the world a better place and trying to impact humanity in a positive way. Oftentimes, like I run into kind of smaller businesses that are just need their voice heard. And I want to be the platform that gives people that voice. Everyone can hear about the big guys in PR, right? Everyone can hear about, you know, the big guys that, you know, are making a splash in the world. Many of them aren't focused on like making a difference in the world. And so I feel like these businesses and these thought leaders that are focused, have a heart-centered approach to business and really making an impact are kind of underdogs. And I want to make them not an underdog. And when I think about, like, as you were talking through, and I think about like my own story and why it's important to me, is because I have always felt like the black sheep in my family. I've always been very different. Like I fell in love and married a black man. I was disowned for 10 years from my mother for doing that. I later realized I was gay. It's like my whole family like disowned me. So I have always been kind of a black sheep and an underdog in my family. And it's been a horrible feeling. it's been a horrible feeling to try to rise above and say, hey, look, I'm really a good person. Even though you may not agree with my choices, maybe you not agree with my lifestyle, you may not agree with who I love, I am really a good heart-centered person. And so I think that story and that drive is what drives me to give voice to other like underdogs, other businesses out there that are just striving to use their gifts to make a difference.
It's really powerful. And like I said, that personal story, I was like, there's usually some type of trigger for somebody mm-hmm. who feels so connected to what their mission and purpose is, especially in the world of media, how abundant it is. There's right. usually a trigger that you can think of that has completely like altered and shifted your life to have so much clarity to take every step forward that you can possible to bring that purpose to the forefront, to help other people who might also have a very shared experience in that mm-hmm. way as well.
Yeah.
So I'm like yeah. that alone. Now it's only if you would want to mold that into your thought leadership message. But I think what a powerful way to say, this is my why. And it's because I struggled with being seen and heard and feeling accepted. And I mm-hmm. want to create a platform to give other people the space to know that they are seen, that they are heard, and that they're accepted in this space.
Yeah. I love that. I love the way you see, this is why you're good at what you're good at. To me, I'm just rambling off like some kind of story and you just like summarized it, accepted or seen, heard, and accepted. Like, okay, there you go. That's the gist of why, yeah, of like why I do what I do and why I work with the people that I work with.
It's so powerful and like such a gift that we'd even be able to even get to this. Like I believe in synchronicities and just letting things lead and guide the way that they're meant to. And it's like the fact that we were able to get there, it's like, that is the why. That is the right. why.
Yeah, I love it. See, this was like a little mini coaching session inside our podcast interview.
Love it.
So let's talk about someone like myself and a bunch of listeners out there that have never dabbled in the world of public relations. How can that impact our business? How can that, elevate our brand to start diving into that world?
Well, I first want to start by kind of shifting the perspective, at least mm-hmm. from my eyes, from the okay. conscious publicist lens, is PR really is the influence of all types of marketing. Now, when we mm-hmm. think about social media or affiliate marketing or even writing blog articles for our website or having a beautifully designed website that has such incredible copywriting that speaks to how we serve and impact and bring people into partnership with us. All of that is attributing to public recognition and public connection. And it's mm-hmm. telling a story and narrative in more ways than you think. Usually, like, we start to think about the steps of starting a business or starting a platform. You know, first we have to figure out exactly where the starting point, and then we just take steps and leaps like throughout the process. I believe that anything that you put out into the world all speaks to PR because it comes down to how you're looking to make connections with those who have never heard of you, have never met you before, mm-hmm. and they have an understanding and idea of what you bring to the table before you are even in connection with that person. So again, that's like a wide lens view. And, mm-hmm. you know, when we talk about like different forms of media as well, I always highly suggest people look into the PESO model, which is paid media, earned media, shared media, and owned media. It kind of breaks all that down into a number of categories of types of media marketing that are contributed into those four categories or those.
So can we break down each of those in the PESO model, the paid media, I forgot what they are, but can you just break down and give me some examples from each of those little categories?
I'll just give like one each because there's like a list. So paid media would be, and I mean, they kind of like all feed in to one another as well. So if you're thinking about paid media, if you're buying like an advertising spot on social media or on another platform, that would be considered paid media. You have to create those assets or that resources in order for the outlet to publish it. And so it kind of fills into owned media and paid media, but essentially you are given media through a paid opportunity to have that media story narrative published.
So earned one example media, would be, go ahead. Earned media. And then I was just thinking about the paid media. I recently did an article in a magazine, in a big magazine that had like 1.5 million subscribers. And they came back to me later and asked me to be a regular contributor to the magazine. But in order for me to do that, I needed to pay them for a spot to be a regular contributor. Would that be paid media?
That, in my eyes, would be paid media.
Okay. All right.
We actually talked about that on our discovery call. I was like, huh.
I think we did. Yes. Yeah.
That alone would be a whole, because I was like, yeah, I remember really going into, I was like, okay, this is, you know, at least from my understanding, you know, where someone like myself and the conscious publicist would come to. Frontline. That's a whole other conversation. I'm like, okay, I don't want to like go into that because I could just like. But we're going to shift into like earned, we're going to shift into earned media because this is like where,
okay,
this is where our focus with the conscious publicist comes into play. Earned media is public relations, media relations, and any type of opportunity that is created based off of that source or that subject matter expert, thought leader, or business earning that opportunity based off of the, what I'm going to say, the know, like, and trust factor is. Media relations is probably one of the biggest influences of earned media because you are, you know, taking the story, the narrative, and positioning that with the media. And it's ultimately the media's choice to bring that voice to their platform based off of the value that you provide to them to bring that story to creation. Let me know if that made sense.
I'm guessing that is like you pitch a story to a local news channel, for instance, or a big, you know, show, for instance, on TV, and they love the story and they decide to accept the story. You've now earned that media.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Perfect example.
Okay. All right.
But then we'll move into shared and owned media. So shared media and owned media, I feel, can actually like blend into one another, but there are separate elements to each type of media. But shared media could be the type of content that you're sharing on social media because it is you creating the content and it's using platforms to share it, but it's in your tone of voice, it's your bylined articles, it's your content, and you are just using different media channels to share that content outwards. Okay. And the reason why I say shared media and owned media are almost kind of one and the same, or they influence one another, is because owned media, again, is your owned media. It's your internal marketing channels, it's your newsletter, it's your blog articles, it's your social media content that you own the rights to because you created it, but you're using the other forms of media, the paid, earned, and shared, as a way to get that media out there. Owned media could also be like your white papers or your ebooks or things of that nature that speak to the credibility of your subject matter expertise or the business itself, industry trends, and you use that as a way to bring awareness to your business, your identity, and then you can just use that content in other forms of media as a way to get it out into the world. Okay. And when you actually look up, if you look up a visual of the PESO model, is you can actually see the overlaps between both. And if we're talking about thought leadership or credibility and authority, usually that is smack dab in the middle of every single form of media working coexist coexisting with one another, working in harmonious with one another to build the credibility, authority, and influence like in the middle of the mix.
Okay. One of the things too that I wanted to touch base with, because we kind of touched base before we hit record, and that is, let's talk a little bit about the future of PR and how it's going to look, or how it might even be changing now, you know, different than maybe what it was 10 years ago. And like, what is it going to be like, you know, maybe 10 years into the future? Like, what are your thoughts about that?
The first thing that's coming to mind for me is, again, it's a focus on the narrative. And I'm just going to put out a new platform that I've been kind of really having a lot of fun with outside of LinkedIn. LinkedIn has always been like my favorite platform because it's created in a way to really focus on thought leadership, the influence of thought leadership, the infrastructure of thought leadership. All their creator tools really speak to the thought leadership journey.
Yes. I love that platform too.
Yes. So fun. So fun. Mm-hmm. But outside of that, you know, I dabble here and there with Instagram's Threads, which is almost kind of a new innovative platform similar to Twitter or X. Mm-hmm. And the reason why I love that platform so much is because you can think about really strong impact points of your narrative to share without having to overcomplicate it. I think like us visionaries and innovators, we get in our heads a lot of like, oh, it needs to be perfect. It needs to be this. It needs to be that in order to make the most impact. But it's like sometimes consistency and just building connections and conversations with other people and just sharing thoughts is a way to gain clarity around what your bigger thought leadership message could be, because it's all perception based. It's all opinion based, which I feel directly connects to narrative. Mm-hmm. So going back to what I believe was the initial question, that it's like, if I was asked a question of like, what can you do right now to get started, is like, use the resources and the platforms that are given to you, because you have them with direct access. And it's a way to play around, to get creative, and to see what type of avenue makes sense for you, or you might get clarity of your own message and you want to expand on it more. It's just a way to, I can't think of a better word, but just like beta test, beta test what your narrative could be, what your message could be, and then see how people respond to it. Mm-hmm. I think that's a big part, you know, at least in somebody in my perspective, it's like, I'm always testing stories, always testing angles, narrative. But I look at the responses that I get, whether actual journalist interest, engagement on social media, looking at trending topics. Mm. Those platforms give you so much insight into what can work for you and what wouldn't work for you. You just have to pay. You just have to pay attention.
Right, right. That's good. Good words of wisdom. Any other like things that you feel like are important that we need to share with listeners?
Yeah. Well, I'm actually going to open up a space to like invite anybody to tune into the Conscious Publicist podcast. That's my show.
Okay. Awesome.
That will give you a really good insight into how I have bridged that connection between like personal narrative as well as business narrative and created a pretty good harmony like between the two.
Okay.
At least in my perspective, because I go through that ideation process with myself, with everything that I create, you know, my hopes is that it really is bridging a connection, that there is a bigger way to look at thought leadership and your message, at least from the conscious lens. But I also have an article. If you want to know a little bit more of the connection between thought leadership and PR, there is an article that was published from myself on Buffer. I can actually send you the link to add into the show notes, but it's
that
pretty
would be
thorough.
Awesome.
It's a little thorough piece that kind of talks through every pillar of what we've highlighted, just in a little bit more like congruent way.
Okay. Okay. Yeah, that's perfect. That sounds amazing. I will definitely put that, I will definitely go read that article, and I will definitely put that link in the show notes. So I always want to close with our famous question that I ask all of our guests, and that is, because we are on a Mission Mojo, what is your personal mojo or that magical superpower that you bring to the world?
I believe my superpower is just my intuition.
Okay.
I have used my intuition in a lot of endeavors, and it is always wonderful to see when I am sensing the right things and also sensing the wrong things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. I know for me, like, I have pretty strong intuitive skills also, but sometimes I ignore them, and it almost always leads to some type of a disaster or just something that's disappointing where I'm saying, why? My intuition told me, I knew the answer to this. I knew what it should have been, a no. And I said yes instead. And now look where I'm at. So that's a lesson for you all, to tune in to your intuition and trust your intuition, because it's rarely wrong.
Yeah. Well, then also a reframe of like looking at the learning lessons.
Yes.
As well,
yes.
That your intuition might be teaching you, because I think everything, yes. Everything, yes, opens up a good learning dialogue.
Absolutely.
For yourself.
It does. Absolutely. So thank you so much, Ashley, for being on the show today. It was just a pleasure talking to you. And I hope that we have shifted some perspectives and got you thinking about just new ways to put yourself out there in the world.
Yes. Thank you so much for having me, Lori. And it's just amazing to be able to share my voice in this way.
Yeah. That's a wrap on today's episode. Thank you for tuning in to the On a Mission Mojo podcast. Ready to dive into more incredible stories of people on a mission? Next week, I'll return with a fresh episode to ignite your passion for creating a better world. If you loved what you heard, be sure to subscribe, leave a glowing review, and spread the word to all your friends. Head over to onamissionbrands.com for more great episodes. Remember, the world needs your mojo, so go out there and let your brilliance shine.